anarchy, a state of disorder, absolute liberation, the absence of any sort of authority, the rejection of all systems, and basically chaos. That is the common notion of anarchy among people, a nihilist, pointless, childish, and irrational way of behaving within a state, rejecting authorities for the sake of individual freedom. Well, that might be the case, but it's not that simple. Many people have a lot of misconceptions about anarchism, as it has been presented frequently by media as just a revolutionary and rebellious ideology that separates people and makes them fight each other. Therefore, many are unaware actually of the origin, essence, and reality of anarchism, and most important of all, the role it played in some great events that occurred in history. That is why in this video, we're gonna talk about how anarchism was actually defined by the politicians and philosophers who theorized it and tried to turn it into an effective political system that could manage the life of people without any forcing powers or authorities. And then we're gonna share some more ideas about it and see how we can use some anarchist principles to improve the perspectives from where we see our personal and social lives. We're gonna also explore how the principle of anarchism can be applied to some domains that are different from politics, like art. The origin of the term anarchy comes from the ancient Greek word anarchia, which is composed of two parts, the prefix an, which means without, and the word archos, which means the ruler. So the term basically means without a ruler. When we add the suffix ism to anarchy, it becomes anarchism, and that's the ideological movement or current that favors and defends anarchy. As for the symbol of anarchy, it is simply an A inside an O. The letter A means anarchy, while O means order. And the idea or the concept of this symbol goes back to a phrase said by the French politician and philosopher Pierre-Joseph Proudhon, who might be the first person to call himself an anarchist. The phrase is, "La société cherche l'ordre dans l'anarchie." And it basically means, "Society seeks order in anarchy." Now this symbol, which is the common and famous symbol of anarchy among people, where we can see the letter A encroaches the letter O, it actually contradicts the concept of anarchy as it is presented in the original symbol. In this symbol, anarchy goes over order, the thing that upsets real anarchists, because anarchy for them is all about order realization. Since anarchism refers to the rejection of authorities, we can say then that it is as old as the first state that appeared in history. And we should also clarify that anarchism is not just about politics, it could be about rejecting religion, art, philosophies, system beliefs, etc. Anything you may think of, there will be a group of people who reject it and don't accept it. Anarchism's roots reach deep in the ancient civilizations of the East. The Taoists, for example, rejected government and taught that everyone can live in natural and spontaneous harmony with themselves and with nature. However, as anarchism is more likely to be considered a recent Western phenomenon, we will focus more on modern philosophers and politicians who are associated with this current. Let us start with William Godwin, who was known for criticizing capitalism as it was in his time. He planted some anarchist ideas in the minds of his contemporaries through his writings. Godwin was the one who made the first attempt of turning anarchism into an effective ideology, even though he never used the terms anarchy and anarchism in his writings. Godwin presented two types of anarchy, one bad and negative, and one hopeful and positive. The negative one is the undeveloped one, the old conception, anarchy as the absence of government and order, so an unattractive state of society. This sort of anarchy is exactly the state that was depicted by Thomas Hobbes as the war of all against all. And the positive one, the hopeful type of anarchy that he defended. This one is about establishing order without the need of government. Godwin taught that that's not impossible as some people think. He based his hope of getting rid of authorities on the idea that men can reach perfection through education, because he believed that education can enable men to manage themselves by themselves without any need of indoctrination,
without any ruling government. To criticize capitalism, Godwin argued that money is the source of all evil. Too much of it creates tyranny. The lack of it creates greed. Some people have to work hard for it, while others just find themselves living in rich families. So he suggested the way to meet the needs of individuals within a society without any use of money. This way simply dictates that the individual needs can be fulfilled with cooperation with others, and everyone gets in return what he needs for his contributions within his society. Every man would have a frugal, yet wholesome diet. Every man would go forth to that moderate exercise of his corporal functions that would give hilarity to the spirits. None would be made torpid with fatigue, but all would have leisure to cultivate the kindly and philanthropic affections of the soul, and let loose his faculties in the surge of intellectual improvement. What a contrast does this scene present us with the present state of human society, where the peasant and the laborer work till their understandings are benumbed with toil, their sinews contracted and made callous by being forever under stretch, and their bodies invaded with infirmities and surrendered to an untimely grave.
The famous English philosopher John Locke, who is commonly known as the father of liberalism, had a big influence on Godwin's thoughts. Godwin believed, just as John Locke, that humans are all born equal, with empty minds that get filled with thoughts and beliefs later because of socialization. Godwin was also pragmatic and utilitarian. He believed that ethics come from the necessity of achieving general benefit, and they are not part of the heaven and hell point of view that religions teach.
Now we're going to move to the French politician and philosopher Pierre-Joseph Proudhon, who might be the first to call himself an anarchist, as we previously said. He did that when he answered the question he asked, "What is to be the form of government in the future?" Proudhon said, "I hear some of my readers reply, 'Why? How can you ask such a question? You are a republican.' A republican? Yes, but that word specifies nothing. Republico, that is, the public thing. Now, whoever is interested in public affairs, no matter under what form of government, may call himself a republican. Even kings are republicans." "Well, you are a democrat." "No, then what are you?" "I am an anarchist." In his famous book, What is Property?, Proudhon concluded that property is theft, and he meant the property of land and means of production. And he prophesied that tyranny will happen even if the proletarian class took power. That's why he criticized Karl Marx for that. He accused him of replacing the aristocratic dictatorship with proletarian dictatorship. So Proudhon concluded that the problem exists within the hierarchy, and even classes will always cause injustice, no matter what are these classes and which class is above the other. So Proudhon insisted on abolishing the states and cancelling government. He basically suggested replacing states with small communities. And instead of applying certain laws on everyone, he suggested that people should make contracts with each other about how they're going to live. Thus, they will obey as the contracts say, because they were the ones who signed those contracts. That is real democracy for Joseph Proudhon. Proudhon expresses his aversion for government in his book, General Idea of the Revolution in the 19th Century, by saying, "To be governed is to be watched, inspected, spied upon, directed, law-driven, numbered, regulated, enrolled, indoctrinated, preached at, controlled, checked, estimated, valued, censored, commanded by creatures who have neither the right nor the wisdom nor the virtue to do so. To be governed is to be at every operation, at every transaction, noted, registered, counted, taxed, stamped, measured, numbered, assessed, licensed, authorized, admonished, prevented, forbidden, reformed, corrected, punished. It is under pretext of public utility and in the name of the general interest to be placed under contribution, drilled, fleeced, exploited, monopolized, extorted from, squeezed, hoaxed, robbed, then at the slightest resistance, the first word of complaint to be repressed, fined, vilified, harassed, hunted down, abused, clubbed, disarmed, bound, choked, imprisoned, judged, condemned, shot, deported, sacrificed, sold, betrayed, and to crown all, mocked, ridiculed, derided, outraged, dishonored. That is government, that is its justice, that is its morality.
Mikhail Bakunin, a famous Russian revolutionary anarchist, his writings defended individual liberty. He criticized the idea that one's freedom can limit others' freedom. Bakunin says, "I am truly free only when all human beings, men and women, are equally free. The freedom of other men is far from negating or limiting my freedom. It is, on the contrary, its necessary premise and confirmation."
Enrico Malatesta, an Italian anarchist and revolutionary socialist. Enrico had a lot of terrible experiences in his life. He spent more than 10 years in prison because of his anti-system thoughts. Enrico criticized the idea that complete freedom of individuals will cause harm to society. He thought that the claim of having absolute liberation in the traditional sense misrepresents anarchism.
Enrico says, "The freedom we want for ourselves and for others is not an absolute metaphysical, abstract freedom, which in practice is inevitably translated into the oppression of the weak, but it is real freedom, possible freedom, which is the conscious community of interests, voluntary solidarity."
So we can say that he agreed with Godwin about the importance of education and how it can enable men to manage themselves by themselves.
Enrico said that anarchism is not an ideology that calls people to rebellion, but rather it just tends to educate people and tell them how authorities should obey the people, while he used to see only the opposite thing happening.
Enrico says, "We anarchists do not want to emancipate the people, we want the people to emancipate themselves."
According to Enrico and also other anarchists, authorities should get the burden of proving their legitimacy. So basically, government do not just have the duty of ruling and governing, but also they have to keep proving that they are able to do so. And that's exactly what Noam Chomsky said in this clip.
Anarchism is a point of view which, first of all, it covers a lot of things. You know, political rhetoric is not the clearest, it's not a model of clarity. And anarchism has covered quite a lot of ground, but the mainstream of it has just been the basic principle, which I think comes straight out of classical liberalism and the Enlightenment, that any form of authority and domination has a burden of proof to bear. It has to demonstrate that it's legitimate, no matter what it is, whether it's inside a family or in the global economy. If it's if it is a form of authority and domination and coercion, it has to show that it's legitimate. If it can demonstrate it's legitimate, and it's a heavy burden to bear. If it shows that it's legitimate, okay, if not, it ought to be dismantled. That's anarchism.
Enrico also agreed with Bakunin on the dependence of the individual freedom on others' freedom, and that freedom is not real until it's shared and common among everyone equally. Enrico says, "By anarchist spirit, I mean that deeply human sentiment which aims at the good of all, freedom and justice for all, solidarity and love among the people, which is not an exclusive characteristic only of self-declared anarchists, but inspires all people who have a generous heart and an open mind."
Since this video is not a documentary but just an introduction to the topic of anarchism, as it is so deep and profound and cannot be presented completely in one video, I am going to introduce some names that had a big influence on anarchism, and please explore them and their works if you want to know more about anarchism.
Now let's talk about anarchism as an ideology and discuss it a little bit. Anarchist theories are not able of solving all social problems. No one claims that, even anarchists themselves. Instead, anarchism defends a system of self-organization through which people try to solve the problems which arise in their specific situation by themselves. It proposes that people horizontally associate as equals and make decisions as a group through a system of direct democracy, in which everyone has a vote and an equal say in decisions that affect them. And that's why most people don't take anarchism seriously, because simply everyone doubts the idea that people can be able to manage themselves by themselves. Socrates, the famous Greek philosopher, criticized and hated democracy for the exact same reason. According to Socrates, democracy is only as good
for the people at their educational level. And in order for democracy to be successful, it should be applied in a utopian state where everyone is educated. And not only that, everyone should also be aware of what the best ruling system is, which until now, no one knows. People only know workable models that are not completely effective. So even if we consider educating everyone, would anarchism still work? Well, education alone still might not solve the problem. Now in the world, we see a lot of intellectual people that no one can deny that they are educated, and still they believe in different ideologies, which make it impossible for them to agree with each other. So even if we were living in an imaginary utopian country where everyone is educated, that won't mean that everyone would agree with each other. And I think the solution for this is to teach everyone how to be able to coexist with people even if you don't agree with them. Principles of communicating ideas with tolerance and without fanaticism or extremism should be learned by everyone. But again, that will subjectify the truth. And also, complete tolerance contradicts some ideologies. For example, you can't be a communist and accept some capitalist ideas. Therefore, how can an individual who holds some communist worldviews live in harmony within the same society of a capitalist individual, and vice versa? Upon which rules and laws are they going to live? And looking at thousands of ideologies in the world, how can a world with such diversity in ideas and system beliefs unite by agreement? اختلاف اللون يؤذينا اختلاف الشكل يؤذينا اختلاف الفكر يؤذينا اختلاف الدين يؤذينا حتى اختلاف الجنس يؤذينا لذا نحاول اغتيال كل اختلاف فينا تحولنا لبعضنا سما زعاف نحن مجتمع أحمق من الحمق نعم نحن مجتمع أحمق من الحمق Proceeding from the liberation that anarchism seeks to achieve, it seems that the view of anarchists is rational in terms of not obeying authorities blindly, but we can't deny that it is also optimistic and idealistic, as they do not see any danger in the abolition of authorities. On the contrary, they see in it only goodness. From the extremist anarchist point of view, all evil stems from the rulers and authorities that impose laws on individuals. These ideas are ideal and overlook many historical facts. Not all rulers in history were bad and evil. In fact, some rulers and some system ideologies were the main reason of the prosperity and the advancements of some countries at certain times. Also, the freedom afforded by anarchism is the same that will allow the strong to rule and subjugate the weak. What we have mentioned in this video leads us to agree on two things. The first thing is that anarchism is a useful method when it comes to revolting against a tyrannical system. And the second thing is that anarchism in itself, if achieved, would be a tyrannical regime. And this is exactly what was expressed by a police officer in Paris commenting on the famous anarchist Mikhail Bakunin. He said, "What a man. On the first day of the revolution, he was a real treasure. But the next day, he should have been shot." In both the 18th and 19th century, anarchism was a must, and anarchists had a big role in big events in history, like the French Revolution, that was the cause of the liberation of all Europe, and the Russian Revolution, and also the Spanish Revolution of 1936. Anarchism is about rejecting, not following blindly. It's about awareness and knowledge. Anarchism tells you to think critically. Do not believe in anything until it's clear to you. If you apply this to your life, you will improve your well-being. You will start feeling that somehow you have control over your mind and therefore your life. You will start giving more value to yourself, just how the Joker went out of his weakness zone and at a certain point decided to start existing. The Joker was abandoned by his society, people were awful with him, and he didn't complain about it. He suffered in private and smiled in public like nothing is wrong with him. But then after he started acting, he started feeling alive.
Everybody is awful these days. It's enough to make anyone crazy.
Okay.
If it was me dying on the sidewalk, you'd walk right over me. I pass you every day and you don't notice me. But these guys, what, because Thomas Wayne went and cried about them on TV?
You have a problem with Thomas Wayne, too.
Yes, I do. Have you seen what it's like out there, Murray? Do you ever actually leave the studio? Everybody just yells and screams at each other. Nobody's civil anymore. Nobody thinks what it's like to be the other guy. You think men like Thomas Wayne ever think what it's like to be someone like me? To be somebody but themselves? They don't. They think that we'll just sit there and take it like good little boys, that we won't werewolf and go wild.
That's just one of the lessons that we could learn from the Joker. Only when you liberate yourself from what has power over you, you become able to possess your own powers and become aware of what you are capable of doing. I am not telling you to be like the Joker. The Joker was psychopathic, and what happened to him encouraged his psychopathic evil side to appear and lead him to kill and cause harm to others. So try to liberate yourself in a more sane way. That's definitely gonna improve the way you see life in general. As we said in the introduction, the anarchist principle of rejecting powers and authorities can be applied in different fields like art. Impressionism was a radical art movement that began in the middle of the 18th century, centered primarily around French painters. Just how the anarchists tried to rebel against the ruling authorities, Impressionists rebelled against classical art schools and embraced modernity. They rejected the criteria that was put in for what art is by the academic art schools in their time. Impressionists reminded the academy of their time that rejected their works that art is subjective and there are no criteria that rule it. Impressionists differed from the artists of their times, as they started drawing objects from nature as they appear to be and not as they are. In this new principle, there is a rebellion not only on the academy of their time, but the whole history of art. And because of this rebellion, a lot of great artistic movements will follow and appear and differ from what's old, just like Impressionism. When you go out to paint, try to forget what objects you have before you, a tree, a house, a field, or whatever. Merely think, here is a little square of blue, an oblong of pink, a streak of yellow, and paint it just as it looks to you, the exact color and shape. Claude Monet says, everyone asks if the absence of rules is a good thing. I would say when it comes to art, it is definitely a good thing, as it gives more space to artists to explore what they are capable of creating. Surrealism attempted as well to abandon traditional artistic rules and liberate art to become a way of expressing nonsense, and not just logical things that make sense to us, like what we see around us in the world. Surrealism went beyond rationality and logic. It gave value to the irrational parts of our existence, parts that don't make any sense but we still experience them, like our dreams for example. The French surrealist André Breton says, Surrealism is based on the belief in the omnipotence of dreams, in the undirected play of thought. Surrealism in art was just like anarchism in politics. It was a revolutionary in what's limited to the right of individual freedom. Dali says, Surrealism is destructive, but it destroys only what it is considered to be shackles limiting our vision. The phenomena of rejecting rules in art appeared also in music. Music has always been known as the art of arranging sounds in time through the elements of melody, harmony, rhythm. Well, atonal music is a style of music that does not adhere to the traditional harmonic concept of a key or mode. The composer Arnold Schoenberg developed this kind of music in the 20s of the last century. Atonal music is arbitrary. It has no order, but that does not stop it from being artistic. That's exactly what makes it artistic. Maybe three last centuries, many artistic revolutionary movements appeared, founded by people who did not believe that art can be limited by certain rules and laws. If it wasn't for their insatisfaction with being ruled and governed by certain authorities, we wouldn't see such variety and diversity in art now. Liberation made us discover how far we can go with our innovations and creative abilities. Experiencing this liberty is priceless. Look for example in this video of this Spanish artist, Victor Moscoso, who makes psychedelic crazy poses
Look how passionate he is about his works, and how he is happy for what he produced after rejecting some academic rules that limited art in his time.
Power. Power to do whatever the fuck I wanted to. Do not use illegible lettering. The purpose of lettering is to communicate. Do not use vibrating colors. They are irritating to the eye. A poster should transmit his message quickly and simply. Neon Rose was my company. I didn't want to be dependent on anybody else. I will print as many posters as I feel like it, and it will be my copyright.